Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, psychologist, professor, author, blogger, podcaster, and your host. Today, our topic is anxiety. If you haven't felt anxious during the last year, you either haven't been paying attention or you're just very, very lucky. We've seen the effects of a deadly pandemic, ongoing racial and social injustice, natural disasters and political unrest here and around the globe. And now, many people are experiencing re-entry anxiety, the stress of deciding if and how we want to re-engage with the world and the people around us as society begins opening back up and vaccines for COVID become more available. Given everything that's going on in our world, there's a lot to feel anxious about. But going back for decades, anxiety was already one of the most frequent problems that brought people into psychotherapists' offices. In fact, as we'll talk about today, anxiety disorders are some of the most common conditions that mental health professionals diagnose. So, what exactly is anxiety? Is it all bad? Most of us have heard of the idea of healthy anxiety, for instance. So, when does it cross the line and become unhealthy? And if we are feeling anxious, what can we do about it? These are just some of the questions we'll explore today. Joining me by phone is Dr. Kevin Chapman. Dr. Chapman is a clinical psychologist, as well as founder and director of the Kentucky Center for Anxiety and Related Disorders. A nationally recognized expert on cognitive behavioral therapy for anxiety, Dr. Chapman frequently serves as a consultant for the creation of evidence-based treatment approaches due to his expertise in the intersection of multiculturalism and mental health, a topic on which he has published numerous papers in scientific journals. Among his many other professional activities, Dr. Chapman regularly contributes to and serves as a consultant for multiple media outlets. Most recently, he served as the program psychologist for seasons 1 and 2 of A&E's documentary, 60 Days In. He also has been featured in U.S. News and World Report, USA Today, and Bloomberg Businessweek, among many other venues, including the Nick News documentary, Worried Sick, Living with Anxiety. And on top of all of this, Dr. Chapman also serves as team psychologist for the Louisville City Football Club. Dr. Chapman, welcome to About Health.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be on the show.
Well, before we dive into COVID anxiety and particularly what's been dubbed re-entry anxiety, I wonder if we could just spend some time exploring what anxiety is in general. In ordinary language, we tend to use words like stress and fear and panic as synonyms for anxiety, but psychologists tend to be a little bit more precise in how they use these kinds of words. So how exactly is anxiety defined that maybe sets it apart from other emotions?
Yeah, that's a terrific question. As you said, Dave, like many people confuse anxiety for fear and worry and use those terms interchangeably, and they're actually very different constructs, though related. So to just clarify, make it simple, honestly, we define anxiety as a future, keyword, future-oriented emotion, and it always involves thoughts of not being able to control or predict outcomes. So it's this idea that there's this sense of threat looming that I have to be prepared for. And we often tell people, of course, that anxiety is, we also call it preparatory coping, which implies that when kept at bay, anxiety is a very healthy, adaptive emotional experience, which, you know, soapbox, anxiety is helpful. Only when it's chronic is it a problem.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So it's that sense of negative, whatever, dread or that feeling that we have when we look into the future and we say, danger, danger, Will Robinson, right? Something's coming down the road that maybe I don't feel like I have control over, if I got that right?
Indeed. And, you know, you think about really basic examples. It's like, think about why we prepare for exams. Think about why we prepare for job interviews. Think about why we prepare for potential relationships that we're unsure about. These are all potential threats, right? Threat is relative. And all of those things don't necessarily mean life or death per se, but they represent some form of it, right? So it's, if I fail this exam, that's a type of threat or death, if you will, right? If I, you know, fail this job interview and it doesn't go as well as I think it should, then that's a type of threat or death, if you will. So it's this idea that I have to be prepared to deal with what might come, and anxiety is preparing me physiologically to respond appropriately to it.
And that really brings us to COVID, right? Because there certainly has been that sense of threat that's been with us since the pandemic began. Am I right to say that since the pandemic began, anxiety has really been on the rise? And of course, we're also hearing a lot in the media now about re-entry anxiety, even as vaccines, which are, of course, a really good thing, are being made more available. Any idea what the percentages are or what you've seen just in terms of the amount of anxiety as you've cared for your clients?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because ultimately anxiety is pervasive anyway in some capacity, because anxiety is an emotional experience that we all experience, which is why that the disorders of anxiety are the most common. So with that said, you know, if you take 40 million people a year diagnosed with an anxiety disorder, it's not that difficult to understand that anxiety has increased as a result of something that has been relatively stressful, literally for everybody on Earth. So because of that, we've seen clinically that there's an increase not only in cases that we've been treating, but also there's been this increase because of COVID of people who haven't been treated yet. It's almost like, again, I use this Malcolm Gladwell term, tipping point. So it's almost like COVID tipped people who may not have been experiencing chronic levels of anxiety to start experiencing chronic levels of anxiety. It's almost like the door opened for them to start manifesting problematic symptoms. So absolutely, anxiety has increased. We've seen it clinically. We've seen it with people that aren't even in treatment yet. But people definitely are talking about the uncertainty associated with reentry. And because anxiety and uncertainty go hand in hand, COVID is one of those things, and reentry into society is one of those things that we literally don't know what that will look like. And therefore, the natural emotional response to that is to experience anxiety.
Yeah, I'm fascinated by this thing that you're talking about with the tipping point, that you have people who have old anxieties that are, it sounds like, that are sort of triggered in a way by living through what many of us have gone through, all of us have gone through in some form or another since the pandemic began, and also that it can create a new anxiety in people as well. How has this affected people who already have certain anxiety conditions? And I'm particularly thinking of people who already had anxiety about their health, or who already had a phobia of germs, or say, obsessive compulsive disorder with compulsive washing. These are things that affect a lot of people. And I'm wondering how all of this has affected them, and has it affected them disproportionately?
It has indeed affected them disproportionately. And it's really interesting because, you know, we can nerd out a little bit in this regard, because when you think about how anxiety and related disorders manifest, typically you see people who come into a clinic setting who come for a specified problem, right? So you have some people who come in and they say, oh, well, you know, I have panic attacks, period. Or I have agoraphobia, period. I have social anxiety, period. Or I have OCD, period. But then you have other people, which is the majority of the cases that we've seen, where they have symptoms of things here and there, right? So it's like, I have social anxiety-ish, but I also have panic attacks occasionally, and also have these things. And what we find is that we're finding a lot more people, because of COVID and the pandemic and the things that have been going on in the world, what we notice is that many people are manifesting a variety of types of anxieties now. So it's not that they came in saying, oh, I have health anxiety, Kevin, or I have illness anxiety, or what we used to call hypochondriasis, right? It's now it's like, whoa, COVID has given me something else to be concerned about. Some of it is realistic, some not so much, but in the case of COVID, it is. It's this idea that, wait a second, this is a normal concern that I have. And oh, by the way, I have loved ones whose health and immune systems may be compromised, and therefore that's another focus area, if you will, to be concerned about.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned everything else going on in the world as well. Besides the pandemic, we've seen brutal killings of Black men and women, often at the hands of the police. As of the recording of the show, we recently received the verdict from the Chauvin trial. the police officer who knelt on the neck of George Floyd. We've also seen a rash of violence directed against the Asian and Asian American communities. And when this show airs, who knows what else will have happened. And these incidents serve to highlight the ongoing reality of racial injustice in our society, which of course isn't new, but it is really being highlighted right now. And I know that one of the things that you've written quite a lot about is mental health and therapy in communities of color. We talk a lot about racial disparities in physical illness, and I'm wondering about disparities in anxiety as well. You're a practicing clinical psychologist, as we've been talking about. Given everything that's happened, have you seen disparities in anxiety levels between persons of color and white clients that you've served?
Yes, indeed. You know, that's a great point, Dave. And I think that I really appreciate you saying that this isn't new, because as you were speaking and asking questions in this regard, that was my thought exactly. And that's what people of color will tell you, is that this isn't new. It's just that the advent of social media and people being what I call accomplices instead of allies, right? So in other words, this idea, we need people to be able to get footage, to be able to show that these things have been going on for years. And then again, in our community, we talk about this idea of we need more accomplices, not allies. So we need non-Hispanic white folks to be paying attention so that they can highlight these issues we've been saying for years, right? So I really appreciate you saying that this is the new. With that being said, I do think that we've seen not only an uptick, but also a disparity as it relates to mental health. As you're well aware as a psychologist, you know, there's always been a stigma associated with mental health in people of color in this country. And I would say that the caveat with that is for very good reason. You know, we've had the Tuskegee experiments. We've had all of this mistreatment with people of color historically. And we've also had a complete disparity with access to care added together with racism, microaggressions, and all of those sorts of things. Mental health is, quote unquote, often deemed as not for us. So with that said, anxiety being an emotional experience experienced by any human on earth, you take that with the idea that there's these racial injustices and actual traumatic experiences that occur on a regular basis. And not only do you see the same types of anxiety in people of color, but you see other types of anxiety that is often dismissed because it doesn't meet criteria, right? So it's like, sure, we're looking for these sorts of things like, oh, is this PTSD? Well, no, black folks seeing other black folks murdered in cold blood is a traumatic experience, right? Seeing footage of this is as if it's happening to me or a loved one. And oftentimes that's overlooked by, oh, well, are you angry about that? So anger, which is not necessarily a pathological thing, that's one of my manifestations of anxiety, right? So ultimately, you see not only the same types of anxiety-related symptoms in people of color, but you also see what's often dismissed as something different. And that is a huge problem. And I think that that definitely is something that we see clinically that needs attention.
And I know you've written about, and I've heard you talk about, the idea of true alarms. You know, we psychologists, we often talk about how anxiety becomes a problem when it sounds false alarms, right? When we're anxious in situations that aren't actually dangerous, and in some sense that interferes with our lives. But you've talked about the idea that in communities of color, in the African American community, in the Asian and Asian American community right now, there's also this concept of true alarms, things that are actually real, that people should be anxious about, and that this might not fall traditionally under the idea of an anxiety condition as psychologists think about it.
Indeed, and I'm glad you said that. Yeah, this idea of true alarms, and just for a distinction for the listeners, we think about the things with regard to, say, social anxiety as a hypothetical. You know, a true alarm in that instance is that if I'm in a social setting and I get laughed at, right? I do something that's actually foolish. Someone turns red in the face, people point, look, laugh, et cetera, put you on social media. That would be deemed as a true alarm. If I have a traumatic experience when I'm, you know, almost fall off a building, or if I get stuck in an elevator, right? These are all instances of these true alarms. When we think about people of color, on the other hand, we have true alarms that take place on a semi-regular basis that aren't deemed as such clinically. So, for instance, we've heard of this idea of driving while black. That's a real thing. As you know, I'm an African-American male, very educated, right, known by people, et cetera. But when I tell my white colleagues, Dave, that when I'm driving in my car and I see, you know, a state trooper or a police officer on the side of the road, please know that I have heart palpitations. Please understand that I have these same experiences and responses. People find that unbelievable, certain people. But people are like, are you serious? You? Yeah, me. Because it's not like I have PhD tattooed on my forehead. That's not what they see.
Sure, good point.
So ultimately, absolutely, that's a true alarm. Being followed in a store when no one else in the store is being followed, that's a true alarm. Being one person of color in a plethora of other people who aren't people of color, and yet people who are, say, given a tour, are looking at you exclusively but not making eye to contact with other people, or the opposite, they treat you like you're invisible. That's also a true alarm. These are all things that people of color experience on a regular basis that accumulate over time and create stress and lead to what you talked about earlier, other health conditions and such too. So yes, absolutely.
And the reality of this ongoing reality of racism causes enormous amounts of stress and trauma among communities of color, and in particular the Black community, from these sort of repeated events. And it's one of the reasons why I find it absolutely a shame that we don't have more Black psychologists in the world. The field needs to do a much better job of recruiting and retaining Black psychologists, in my opinion, at least. I know, for instance, as a gay man myself, when I sought therapy many years ago, when I made the decision to come out to my friends and family, I really wanted to see a gay psychologist, because I felt like someone who was a member of the LGBTQ community who shared maybe some of my experiences could better understand me, would be in a better position to help me think through what was going on in my life, so I didn't have to constantly explain myself. And I think about that with regard to communities of color as well. If I'm not mistaken, only something like, is it 4% of psychologists are Black? Have I got that right? And I just wonder if you could reflect on the effects of that on potential clients for a minute or two.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. I think that, you know, give or take studies, up to 4%, you know, I was familiar with more of like a 2%. Mm. And then you think about PhDs being a very small percentage, maybe even 2% of the population. Mm. Those numbers get extremely low. And yes, I do agree, Dave, that it's this idea of not only just racial match, but cultural match that's essential in the therapeutic environment. And that's something that we've definitely done research on, noting that cultural match is extremely important. Racial match is extremely, like, you know, icing on the cake, so to speak. But with that said, it's very complicated. It really is, because ultimately, on the one hand, you know, we've had these educational gaps and disparities for decades. So because of that, then you have Black folks who don't have the same access to education and therefore can't apply to grad school. Yeah. to go on to be a Black psychologist. And then you have, again, you have this idea of how we recruit and accept people into psychology programs. So that's an issue, just because, again, if we have an educational disparity, oftentimes we don't have the same access to things like GRE study prep and things like that. So that's an issue. But then at the same time, like I mentioned earlier, there's the stigma associated with mental health. Has it improved? Absolutely. Is it still a problem? Absolutely. So therefore, you have many of us, Black folks and people of color, who are like, why would I want to go into psychology? Because if I'm going in an environment in the quote-unquote ivory tower, there's no one that looks like me, I don't have the support academically that I'm going to need. I oftentimes don't have a mentor that looks like me, and I definitely don't have people around me who understand my shared experience with other Black folks. So it's a very complicated problem, and that really contributes to it as well, this idea that I don't have someone to help hold me accountable, to mentor me, to speak the right things into me, and so on and so forth. Even if people are well-intentioned, they still may not have that same shared cultural experience.
Yeah, and I just want to say amen to all of that. And I constantly am thinking, wow, what a better world it would be for persons of color if there were more psychologists of color, and for African Americans, if there were more Black psychologists who could share some of their experiences, who could have that cultural match, who would be able to, I think, get it and connect in a way that maybe I can't, even with the best of intentions, as a white person myself. And one of the questions that I've been asked a lot as a psychologist is how to approach the news, particularly when it broadcasts and rebroadcasts videos of these brutal racist killings. I mean, in a way, that's a really good thing, right? That broadcasting these, having these go viral on social media means that it raises consciousness, and maybe, just maybe, that will end up getting people to do something and actually make the world a better place in the long run. But at the same time, I'd imagine it's incredibly traumatic for Black clients, for instance, for Black people, to be seeing this broadcast and rebroadcast constantly. When you've worked with Black clients and clients of color in general, how do you advise them to approach the news?
Yeah, that's a great question, Dave. I think that, again, this comes back to the true alarm conversation that we've been having.
Sure.
And, you know, again, just to highlight to your point that you've been making, as a Black male specifically myself, you know, I have to practice what I preach, if that makes sense. So in other words, when I'm thinking about how to advise Black clients and other clients of color about how to approach the news, you think about trauma responses and traumatic events, certainly the news, which is a very good thing, because again, on the one hand, it's highlighted the need for social justice and racial justice and such, because people see it now more than ever. But also at the same time, you have to take it in doses. It's almost like you putting yourself in a situation where you're asking to be re-traumatized, and it's something that occurs, and our reactions to that aren't pathological. Our reactions to seeing the killing of other folks that look like us is most certainly an adaptive response, but ultimately, it not only does it make us re-traumatized when we see too much of the media, but it also highlights and underscores our Blackness. And that's the thing that I think a lot of people don't realize, is that not only is it re-traumatizing to watch and witness, because it really is witnessing, even though I'm not there physically present, I'm there because, again, we have this shared cultural experience. It's almost as if it's happening to me,
sure,
or a loved one, or could. So there's that piece, but also it highlights the idea that, wow, when I finish watching this clip, when I leave today, like now all of a sudden I'm more hypersensitive to my Blackness, looking around, seeing who's following me, someone looking at me the wrong way, like all this idea of healthy paranoia. And we talk about that oftentimes in communities of color, this idea of healthy paranoia, because the paranoia is healthy. Because things could actually happen to you. And it is something that has happened to us. So absolutely. So it's this matter of approaching the media in a flexible way. You can be well-informed and not re-traumatized. It's important to know what's happening, but it's not healthy to watch footage, for instance, of injustices done toward Black folks.
Yeah. A few months ago, I interviewed Dr. Monica Williams, who is an expert also in anxiety and particularly in racial stress and trauma. And she was saying that for her, she actually didn't watch, for instance, the George Floyd video. She said, look, I want to be informed. It's important that I'm a citizen of the world, and I want to take action to make the world a better place. But I can know what happened without constantly watching it over and over and over again. So I need to find that balance where I can be informed and do what I need to do to make the world better and fight for social justice, but at the same time, not constantly re-traumatize myself, because if I'm remembering what she said correctly, that actually detracts from my ability to do what I need to do to fight this. Is that basically what you're saying?
Indeed. And my homegirl, Monica, friend of mine, she certainly is going to say what I would echo, and that is absolutely true. I can be informed. In fact, I'd argue, and she would as well, that you should be informed.
Sure.
At the same time, you don't have to subject yourself to something that is absolutely going to be re-traumatizing.
Yeah. Well, you're listening to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest is psychologist Kevin Chapman, expert in the treatment of anxiety. And indeed, we're talking about anxiety, particularly zooming in on anxiety due to the COVID pandemic and everything else that's been going on in our country and in the world. We'll also be talking about re-entry anxiety, that anxiety that can occur as people consider if and how to engage differently with the world and people around them after they've been vaccinated. Because this is a pre-recorded show, unfortunately, we're not able to take calls today. So, Dr. Chapman, you were referring to healthy paranoia. And that really brings us, I think, to this idea of adaptive versus maladaptive anxiety. It seems to me, as I think it does to you, that a certain amount of anxiety, given everything that's going on in the world, is rational and reasonable. We've heard a lot, I'm sure everyone has listening, that anxiety can be either good or bad for us, so-called adaptive and maladaptive anxiety. Can you talk a little about the difference between these two kinds of anxiety and when exactly anxiety can be something that's actually healthy for us?
You know, it's interesting because we do often talk about this idea of anxiety being adaptive versus maladaptive. And I would say, I would even jump on a soapbox, Dave, and say that I think that the majority of society presumes anxiety is a bad thing. Mm. And that's interesting because as clinical psychologists and researchers, we're well aware that that's far from true. Anxiety at its core is a very adaptive emotional experience. Hence what I said earlier, which is what we call it in the laboratory, preparatory coping. It's trying to prepare us to cope with future threat. So what we often say is that anxiety is rarely a problem unless it's chronic. So with that criteria in mind, I think that it's really important to understand the difference between adaptive, healthy levels of anxiety and maladaptive. Ultimately, adaptive anxiety helps us achieve a goal. For instance, if I have an exam coming up and my heart's palpitating, I'm having shortness of breath, I'm not hungry, which actually, with parentheses, my digestion is slowing down, close parentheses. Ultimately, it's trying to prepare me to prepare for the exam and not to eat. So those sensations that I have in my body, though uncomfortable, are certainly tolerable and manageable and trying to tell me to prepare for the test. When I prepare for the test, which is what the anxiety is trying to tell me, the anxiety subsides. So there's a check mark. It's saying, wow, I responded in a very healthy, adaptive way to my anxiety. On the other hand, when anxiety meets the criteria of other problematic syndromes and such, and that is when it causes personal distress and it impairs my functioning in some capacity, whether that be with work, with relationships, with school. In other words, the anxiety is much more intense than is necessary for the situation that I'm facing, and it prevents me from engaging in goal-directed behavior. That's when anxiety is maladaptive. That's when avoidance behaviors, for instance, are problematic, because one of the hallmark features of anxiety is avoidance, which gives me temporary relief, but it's a paradox because that relief is temporary and it backfires and perpetuates the anxiety I was trying to get rid of.
So if I'm understanding you correctly, you're saying that anxiety under a lot of circumstances, at least in manageable amounts, can help us cope and plan and protect ourselves. I hope I'm getting that right. But you're also saying that when it gets too intense, it can lead us to avoid things that we should be engaging with. Talk a little bit more about that avoidance and how that can get us in trouble in the case of anxiety.
Yeah, that's a great point. And when you think about the two outcomes of anxiety, what we know from research is, to simplify, there are two outcomes that we have when we have chronic anxiety. Number one, we engage in avoidance behavior, or we engage in worry. And I think that that's an interesting point, because like we said earlier, anxiety and worry tend to be used synonymously, but worry, just like avoidance, are things people do in response to anxiety as an attempt to manage it. So in other words, when I have something coming up that is important to me, my life, my functioning, and my anxiety and my arousal in my body is so intense, and I interpret it as, oh no, something dangerous is going to happen if I don't manage this anxiety, I have to get rid of these symptoms. Dave, the issue is that I'm focused more on the symptoms themselves as opposed to the thing that I need to manage. And what happens is people, because of human nature, they create this learned association. So it's, this situation must be threatening because my body is seemingly telling me so. So I'm going to do anything I can in my power to prevent that from happening. And the thing that works the fastest is to avoid or escape the situation. Then I can wipe my brow and walk away and feel better. I can watch Netflix. I can binge watch shows. I can do these things. But that's short-lived too, because the demand is still there. And now my anxiety is more chronic than it was to begin with.
Right. So if we're anxious about a test, say, just as an example, and the thing that would really, on the long term, help us to be less anxious would be to study for the test, prepare for the test, et cetera. And instead, we avoid studying, we avoid preparing because it relieves our anxiety in the short run. That's really when it becomes a problem. Have I got that right?
Indeed, that is correct. That is absolutely correct.
And I think that really brings us back to the pandemic. It seems like this is a case where having anxiety and avoiding things can actually be healthy. I'll just speak for myself. I've certainly had a heightened level of anxiety since the pandemic began. I imagine I'm not alone. And that's led me to avoid all kinds of things. I've avoided going out. I've avoided standing too close to people. I've avoided meeting people in person. I've avoided touching things unnecessarily, including my face. I've avoided going shopping unnecessarily when I might normally enjoy going shopping. So what I struggle with is that under normal circumstances, most psychologists would say that someone who avoids all these things would have an anxiety disorder, say agoraphobia or illness anxiety disorder, what used to be called hypochondriasis. But we're not living under normal circumstances. Any thoughts about how we can tell whether we're avoiding too much? Does that make sense?
It does make sense. And the word that struck me with your question was, or with your comment at least, was this idea that I've unnecessarily avoided situations. And I think that that's where reentry anxiety and COVID, Dave, are so interesting, because we could really argue easily that it may not be unnecessary avoidance. Mm. Because in many ways, via CDC guidelines, it makes a lot of sense for us to, quote unquote, avoid situations that we typically did not. So in many ways, again, I think that what's so important for us to remember here is that I think the term I'd use to summarize everything we've said thus far is that we have to approach not only reentry, but COVID in and of itself with flexibility. And I think that that is a key term, is being flexible. It makes a lot of sense to be flexible. How's that? Well, it's saying, what are the guidelines? What are the best practices? We have that very well, and it's covered on CDC guidelines. It's been effective. It's been working. So therefore, if I follow those guidelines and yet still do the other things while following those guidelines, that's probably a really healthy way to approach reentry and to approach COVID-related anxiety.
Yeah, I think that's good advice. And the guidelines are, you know, still relatively clear, although they shift sometimes as the CDC sort of reevaluates. And people sometimes take that to mean they're not clear. But at any one time, you can look up what the CDC recommends. And I think that that's a smart thing for people to do at any point as a way of both keeping themselves safe, and also palliating their anxiety, perhaps, so that they know they're doing what is necessary. And I guess this leads me to ask about the issue of ambiguity or uncertainty, because I think this is something that people also struggle with in the midst of the pandemic. People take different amounts of precautions, and we don't always 100% know what will keep us safe, what will not, et cetera. And we've certainly seen lots of uncertainty, even given the hopefulness that the vaccines have brought to so many people. As we're recording this show, for instance, we've got new strains of the virus, although the vaccines seem to be working fairly well against the new strains. We hear reports, sometimes substantiated, often unsubstantiated, but still alarming to a lot of people about side effects or possible side effects from some of the vaccines. And many of us just have questions about how to get back to some semblance of life as normal, whatever that is. In a way, it occurs to me that there's almost more ambiguity now. There's less certainty now, particularly about how to act, than there was at the height of shelter in place. I know it's a big question, and nobody will hold you responsible for not having a crystal ball, but do you think anxiety is going to go up or down as society opens up, provided that the vaccines continue to be effective?
Great question. And people who know me personally, they would tell you I'm very optimistic. With that said, though, considering what we know about anxiety in general and how it's the most prevalent type of mental health condition, and considering what COVID has introduced to us, which is, again, ambiguity and uncertainty, as you laid out already, Unfortunately, I would predict that anxiety absolutely increases. And it makes sense why it would increase, because ambiguity and uncertainty would increase. And COVID has already, again, tipped people who had pre-existing anxiety to manifest it even more, or people who had anxiety kept at bay are beginning to manifest it clinically, because ambiguity and uncertainty, and this is one of my favorite quotes, ambiguity and uncertainty are not threatening, but they most certainly are uncomfortable. And I think oftentimes we remember that people who have a propensity to be anxious, right, tend to deem and perceive uncertainty and ambiguity as threatening, when in reality they are not. So because of that, reentry anxiety is a real thing. It's certainly a normal thing to have that we shouldn't judge. But at the same time, it's unfortunately going to likely trigger more cases of anxiety because of the pre-existing blueprint, if you will, for people to experience it.
And that really does bring us to the topic we've been dancing around this whole interview, which is reentry anxiety. Many of us have spent the last year somewhat isolated in our homes, at least more isolated than normal, avoiding going out, concerned about catching COVID. And now we have vaccines, so we can venture out more, see friends in person, etc. And this is a good thing, of course, but it's also causing some people considerable anxiety. So I wonder, can you just take a minute to define reentry anxiety for listeners and talk about maybe some of the things that you're seeing in the clients that you serve?
Yeah, so I would define reentry anxiety, to be very specific and precise, as anxiety about reentry, anxiety about reentering society post-COVID due to the ambiguity and uncertainty of what that will look like. And I think that, again, when you define reentry anxiety that way, there's nothing pathological whatsoever about that. Ultimately, that anxiety makes a lot of sense because we're not sure, hence reentry anxiety in the definition that I'm posing. And I would say, Dave, that the things that I'm seeing with people and the things that I would predict would be, I think social anxiety would be on the increase. Considering it's the third most common mental health condition in the United States and the number one most common anxiety disorder specifically, is if you think about the definition of social anxiety, it's a pervasive pattern and a persistent fear of social or performance situations where negative evaluation may occur. Well, if you think about what reentry anxiety could do to folks, when we go into society in certain contexts, we're not sure what people are going to say. If you say aren't wearing a mask and the mandate is that you don't have to at that point, some people might still say, hey, you need to put a mask on. Or is it that if I'm wearing a mask, people look at me funny because other people aren't? Or so there's all this uncertainty.
Yeah, can go either
and
way.
Ambiguity. So indeed. So I'm finding that masks have temporarily relieved a lot of people's anxiety because you can't see facial expressions. But many people that I've spoken with are anxious about when you can see their facial expressions. So we have this idea of social anxiety increasing, health anxiety, illness-related anxiety about getting COVID or a loved one getting COVID is something that we're seeing on the increase, and worry about the same things we just aforementioned, which is my loved ones could get COVID. My loved ones may not want to leave the home now because they've been there so long. So we have more agoraphobic avoidance. So there's a litany of things, Dave, at this stage that we're seeing clinically that COVID has, again, tipped many of our existing clients into having health anxiety, illness-related anxiety, worry, social anxiety, and even agoraphobic avoidance.
I think the point you've made about social anxiety is so important because, of course, people are thinking about health anxiety, and that's very much a real thing that's on people's mind. But I also think that this social anxiety business is key because we have changed the way we socialize. We're socializing perhaps through Zoom, through the phone. We're using the internet more. We're not meeting face-to-face. And I suppose that that has been a relief maybe to people who are a bit shyer, who have some social anxiety and some fear in social situations. And now, of course, they're going to, in some sense, have to get back to that. It's something that's really never occurred to me in a huge way. And I imagine that that's going to be one of the big ones, yes?
I do agree with that. I think so, because it's a double-edged sword, right? On the one hand, I am interacting, and because of technology and advances and such, that's been helpful. On the other hand, it's also been problematic because in some sense it's inhibited our ability to socialize. And the interesting thing about that scientifically is that social anxiety has the most unique relationship with depression in the sense of positive emotional expression. They're both really low in that regard. And where do we experience positive emotional expression the most? In social interaction with other people. So ultimately, you could see that if I'm inhibited in my ability to perform, quote unquote, and socialize and interact with people that are my friends and my loved ones, you could see that my expression of positive affect or positive emotion is going to be lowered or lessened, because that's where we tend to laugh and joke and hug and show affection, is in the company of other people.
Yeah. Important points. Well, I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest today on About Health is Dr. Kevin Chapman, psychologist and expert in the treatment of anxiety. And as you can hear, we are talking about anxiety, particularly reentry anxiety, as people are vaccinated for COVID and consider if and how they'd like to increase their interactions with the world and change how they engage with other people and the world around them. Because this is a pre-recorded interview, unfortunately, we can't take calls today, which is a shame because I would imagine we'd have a lot of them. So, Dr. Chapman, everything you've been talking about really makes me think of the 22-year-old daughter of a pretty close friend of mine. She was recently vaccinated against COVID, and she expected to feel really happy and really relieved. And I think there was a little bit of that. But what she actually found herself feeling was really anxious. In fact, she's more anxious now than she was during the more intense phases of the lockdown, because it's expected now that she will venture out more. What advice do you have for anyone who might be listening and maybe feeling the same way, particularly given that there still is, as we've been talking about, at least some risk of COVID, at least or even after you've been vaccinated? I know, for instance, you were featured in an article on today.com, and you talked about a five-step process for combating anxiety that goes by the acronym FIGHT.
Indeed. I think that, you know, the FIGHT acronym, I think, Dave, is a really good simplistic, practical suggestion to answer your question about what advice that I would give someone who's still experiencing the anxiety that many of us are experiencing, even if we've been vaccinated. And the FIGHT acronym basically takes the science of psychology, cognitive behavioral therapy, which is the gold standard treatment for anxiety and related symptoms, and really making it practical and soundbite. So to just in a very succinct way to break down that acronym, the advice is as follows. The F is to focus on what I can control. And that's a very important point, because the only thing I can control technically, to make it simple, is the present moment. I can't control 3 hours from now or 3 days ago, but what I can do is focus on what I can control. What can I do behaviorally in this present moment and focus on what's important right now in this present moment, and to take each moment at a time, to be very present focused in my emotional awareness, is an extremely important point. So taking each step of my day and focusing on the present moment is a very, very important strategy as we re-enter. The I in the acronym is to identify negative thoughts. And we all have a number of negative thoughts about re-entering society and the anxiety related to COVID and such. And there's nothing wrong, and that's a very important point, with negative thoughts. The issue is that negative thoughts fuel the intensity of strong emotional experiences. And once we identify the thoughts that we have, hypothetically, like, oh, this is never going to end. There's nothing wrong with the thought, this is never going to end. The problem is not that that thought is wrong. The problem is that that thought restricts what emotions I can experience. So if I say this is never going to end, the only emotion I can really experience are anxiety or frustration when there's other possibilities. So identifying negative thoughts, the G is generating what I call flexible thoughts, Dave. And generating flexible thoughts is key. I didn't say positive thoughts. I said flexible thoughts. And being flexible is being able to entertain other possibilities as opposed to what I just noted, which is restricting what emotions I experience by saying this will never end. Could it be that the data suggests that we're going in the right direction as a nation as it relates to COVID and the pandemic? Could it be that I might enjoy this activity much more than I expected? Could it be? So it's the generation of those multiple possibilities, those thoughts, those appraisals, as we say, that is key to regulating my emotions, not being positive. There's also the H in the FIGHT acronym, and that is highlighting adaptive behaviors. what can I do to support my loved ones? What can I do in the community to help those around me who may not have access to, say, grocery shopping, who may not have access to, say, being able to engage in exercise-related activity? How can I engage in an adaptive response to not only help myself emotionally, but to help someone around me? Which brings me to the final point, Dave, and that's the T, and that is to teach someone else. And that's the thing you and I both love, Dave, about cognitive behavioral therapy, is that it is a collaborative enterprise. How can I teach someone else to be their own psychologist? Well, one way I could do that is to tell them exactly what I just said to the listeners.
Yeah. I think this is such a wonderful acronym, the FIGHT acronym, and it really encapsulates, as you referred to me, I'm a CBT therapist, and I sometimes struggle to take cognitive behavior therapy and to give it away to the public in a way that is worthy of a soundbite, right? That really is pithy and helps people to carry something with them that will help them in the moment. And that's why I really love this acronym. And I thought that we could spend the remainder of our time kind of going through the pieces and really getting down to nitty gritty so that if people are feeling anxious, whether that's anxious about COVID in general, anxious about anything in their life, anxious about reentering society, about society opening back up, or anything else, people will have something that they can fall back on. So let's start with the F, if it's okay, which is focus on what you can control. And you said that it's so important to be in the present moment. Listeners of this show will know that we have talked a lot, both myself and my co-host, Nurse Rona, about mindfulness and mindfulness meditation and those kinds of techniques. For instance, we had on Dr. Shauna Shapiro a couple of times in the last couple of years, who's really an expert in mindfulness and self-compassion. Is that what you're talking about in terms of being in the present moment and focusing on what you can control? Are mindfulness techniques helpful here?
As we say in sports-related activity, I was a college athlete, and I do sports performance work as well, Dave. And one of the things that we say in sports often is, nailed it. And that's exactly what you did. You just nailed it. That's absolutely what I'm referring to, is being mindfully aware of my emotion. And that's literally when I'm telling people on a regular basis clinically, when I'm saying focus on what you can control, I literally am borrowing from the mindfulness-based science in that regard, because we know that is a very healthy way to regulate any emotional experience that I have, by being non-judgmental about my emotions, but also learning skills to be present via mindfulness.
Mm. And I think that that's something that comes from practice, right? People often try to sort of force themselves to be in the present moment. Certainly my experience is that it's very hard to will yourself to just be in the present moment. You really have to start simple. And one of the things that I like to recommend to people is that they perhaps take a walk. Maybe they go to a nearby park or something and really just practice being mindful. Really notice the breeze flowing through the leaves, and really notice the temperature on your skin, and appreciate the sun shining down if there is sun that day, and really just spend some time really focusing on those sensations to kind of get out of your mind and into what's going on in the situation. Would you endorse that kind of practice? And are there any other practical practices that you would recommend to people to just become a little more mindful of the present moment, so you're not constantly forecasting doom and gloom in the future?
Yeah, I do agree with that. I think that's a phenomenal suggestion. And I think also in addition to that is to do some guided meditation. We have a plethora of apps that do that, right? Headspace is an example of that. And we have these apps where people actually guide you through focusing on your breathing right now, how your body's feeling against the couch right now, focusing on the five senses as they're happening in the present moment, noticing your thoughts and not judging them, just letting them ebb and flow like emotions do. Because really what it does is it's teaching me not only to be in the present moment, but it's also teaching me how to not judge what emotions I'm experiencing. And that's the other component of that I think is so incredibly important and helpful for people to understand, is that your emotions serve an adaptive purpose, and mindfulness exercises help you be more aware of those and not push them away, because you lose sight of what they're trying to tell you when you do that.
Yeah, it's great advice. And I also want to at least get to a couple of the other letters in your acronym FIGHT, although we might not be able to get to all of them. And that is this business of the next two letters, identifying negative thoughts and then generating flexible thoughts as a response. And I just wanted to give you a chance to highlight again that point you were making about this isn't about painting a smiley face over real fears and concerns. There really are things to be concerned about. This is really about learning to speak to ourselves, if you will, or to have thoughts that are realistic, that are balanced, that take into account, yes, the real dangers in our environment, but also, I suppose, the good things in our lives as well.
Indeed. And that's why I refer to it as flexible, right? Because even in our racial injustice discussion, you know, oftentimes with SCBT folks, you know, it's not about changing thoughts, right? Because we do experience discrimination and such. Yeah. The key is not necessarily being positive and Pollyanna. That's not the key. The key is saying, what's a flexible way to navigate my environment so that I can actually live and be healthy and regulate despite still maybe experiencing anger and frustration, which are adaptive emotional experiences. And I think the problem, Dave, that most people have, hence why it's important to identify negative thoughts and to identify more flexible ones, is that most times people who experience strong emotions, they treat their feelings as facts. And the reason they do that is because there's a quality to their thoughts that restrict what emotions I experience. And that's the issue. So it's this issue that if I only want to be anxious, said no one ever, or if I only want to be angry, said no one ever, then I can guarantee that you can be if you say that your thoughts, or if you say that your thoughts are facts. Like, I know that this is going to go poorly. No one can predict what's going to happen in 3 hours. But nonetheless, if I say that sort of thought, that's going to guarantee no money back that I will only be anxious. Mm-hmm. So the problem with that thought is that it's inflexible. So when I can look at evidence to objectively see other ways of thinking and point of view, that expands what emotions I can experience. So that's the key, is being flexible in how I'm thinking, not being right.
Right. We can say to ourselves, you know, there really is danger in this situation. There really are things that are happening that are bad in my life or in the world. But at the same time, we can say, there are also strengths that I have that might enable me to deal with this without denying the reality of perhaps danger and bad things happening in my life and the world. And that really leads us to the last two pieces of your FIGHT acronym, which are highlighting adaptive behaviors and teaching others. And we only have maybe about a minute and a half or 2 minutes left in this interview, but I wonder if you can just talk a little bit about those and maybe offer some practical suggestions for people who are listening about things that they might be able to do right now, today, if they're anxious, to help themselves and perhaps even to help others.
You know, one of the most important pieces of mental health just time and time again with science that's been proven over time, that the relationship between exercise, which doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be in CrossFit shape to exercise. The point is that if I move around at all, that's going to have a positive effect on my emotional experience. And I've done a number of interviews about the power of exercise. And it's so incredibly important that two things happen with the engaging in adaptive behaviors and teaching someone else. Number one, moving around at all, Dave, is so incredibly important. When I exercise, that has a tremendous effect on my health and my mental health and wellness. So being able to do that, whether it's with someone virtually or by myself or walking down the street, if I'm not even used to walking to the mailbox, that in and of itself is helpful for some people. So I say that to say that if I'm engaging in any sort of behavior where I'm moving around, that is extremely important. And in many cases, in most cases, that people can do something in that regard. I think the other thing is not being a passive bystander, being able to help other people around me by telling them about the FIGHT acronym or by saying, what's something that I can do, which would be like a pro-social act to help you navigate a situation. Can I get you groceries? Can I help you with an email? Can I help you make a certain phone call? Can I take you down the street in my car? Like, whatever it might be, to help someone else around me is also not only going to have a positive effect on my mental health, but it's also going to affect changing somebody else.
Well, that's a wonderful, hopeful note to end our interview. And we're going to have to leave it there. Dr. Kevin Chapman, thank you so much for spending time with us today. If people want to learn more about you or your work, how could they go about doing that?
Yeah, and I want to thank you too, Dave, for having me on, and I would certainly be delighted to be on again. And I would say if people want to get in touch with me, I'm definitely on social media, and I have a couple different websites that people can go to. You can go to drkevinchapman.com, or you can go to our center's website, which is kycards.com, Kentucky Center for Anxiety and Related Disorders, so kycards.com. Twitter, at Dr. Kchap, D-R-K-C-H-A-P is my Twitter handle, and you can find me on Instagram as well, which is Dr. Kevin Chapman.
Well, thanks again so much for joining us on About Health.
Thank you, Dave. I appreciate it. Take care.
And my thanks to all of you, our listeners. You're the reason we do this. And I sincerely hope that this hour has been helpful to you. I'm David B. Feldman. If you'd like to find out more about me, you can visit my website, davidfeldmanphd.com, all one word. If you'd like to hear this episode again or listen to any of our past episodes, you can find them on kpfa.org. Just select About Health under the Programs page. And of course, I hope you'll continue to join us here each week as we explore important issues impacting your health. From all of us here at About Health, may you be healthy, happy, and wise. Thanks for listening.
Electoral College was in part a racialized system. We have a system where the South is going to come into the Union. They want to make sure that they have parity with the North. They don't have as many people. So they come up with this ingenious plan. We are going to count the slaves, who everybody knows is not really people. We're going to count them for the purpose of adding to our leisure the number of people in our state. It's called the three-fifths clause. And some people get confused and they say slaves were only considered three-fifths of a person. Slaves were not considered a person at all. It was the slave master that actually was enhanced by counting the slave, not the slave. And it created relative parity between the North and South. And so the first several presidents, including Jefferson, would not have won without the three-fifths clause.
Advancing the conversation to abolish racism for over 70 years. 94.1 KPFA.
Hey, are you a KPFA member who wants to vote in the ongoing Pacifica Bylaws referendum, but have not received your electronic ballot by email? If so, please go to elections.pacifica.org and fill out a ballot request form. Or call and leave a message for the election supervisor with your name, home address, email, and phone number at 510-993-0320. The deadline to request paper ballots is June 25th, and the deadline to request electronic ballots is July 6th. All votes must be received before 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on July 7th. For more information on the bylaws referendum positions, please find the 2021 Bylaws Voter Guide at elections.pacifica.org. It's 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 ABR in Santa Cruz, and online at KPFA.